பெரிய புராணம், த ஸ்டோரிஸ் ஆஃப் 63 சைவைட் சயின்ஸ், கண்ணப்ப நாயனார் ஸ்டோரி இஸ் பீயிங் கண்டினியூடு. பை திஸ் டைம் த சீஃப்டெயின் நாகன் ஹேட் பிகம் ஓல்ட் அண்ட் வீக். ஹீ ஹேட் பீன் ப்ரொடெக்டிங் ஹிஸ் ட்ரைப் ஃபார் லாங் அண்ட் ட்ரையம்ஃப்ட் ஓவர் ஹிஸ் ஃபோர்ஸ், பிரிங்கிங் ஹோம் மச் பூட்டி. பட் த ஸ்ட்ரெயின் வாஸ் நவ் டெல்லிங் ஆன் ஹிம். One day, the tribesmen gathered around him and told him that the periodical hunt of wild beasts, the hogs, tigers, bears, wild buffalo, the stags, and so forth, was overdue and that the beasts were proving a menace to the hamlet. Hearing this, Nagan, realizing that old age was enveloping him, said to the elders, "As I have grown old, I cannot engage myself in hunt as before. I pray that you take my son as your chief henceforth." The tribesmen were at once sad and pleased to hear this. They said, "These long years we had prospered under your fostering prowess. Dear Lord, we would stay under your grace still. Nevertheless, you have got and bred a matchless scion, this hero, Thinnan. May your glory increase. Send for the mighty bowman, your son, and hand over to him the reins of the tribal rulership to our great joy." This recalls the second sarga of Valmiki's Ayodhya Kanda. Responding, Nagan sent for the old traditional priestess to conduct the rites for the maiden venture of the prince. The priestess, with the withered breasts, came hurrying in all her ceremonial attire and blessed the chief by sprinkling bamboo rice akshanta over him. The chief inquired about her welfare and she assured him that his benefaction were continuing. Then the chief told her that his blemishless son Thinnan was that day to be invested with the rulership of the tribe. Being made over to him willingly and asked her to arrange for the customary offerings to be made to the tribal guardian deities to assure prosperity. The old dame said to the hunter chief, "Naga, I saw very good omens on my way here. Your son Thinnan will prove to be a far more triumphant bowman than yourself." Then she made offerings to the tribal deities and left. The fond father now beckoned to his son, who came like a glittering blue gem of a mountain on the move, and paid his respects. Embracing his son's clothes, Naga seated him on the ancestral tiger skin rest and said, "Due to my old age, I am not able to hunt as before, and I have given up that idea altogether. So I bid you now take all this responsibility of guardianship of this tribe, and proving yourself far better than I have been, overcome your foes and hunt the wild animals." Thinnan was next invested with the royal sword and shield, which he did not decline, conscious of his filial duty. His thoughts, however, were then centered on the Supreme Lord. Feeling at ease, Naga next asked the son to go forth with to the chase along with hardy followers, blessing him with success in his venture. Thinnan adored the feet of his hardy blessed father, bathed in the sacred stream, and rested the night in his abode. At break of day, skilled craftsmen dressed him from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet in the traditional manner. Flowers symbolizing victory at the front and rear of his curly tresses, thread of white and red on the brow, chank earrings shining like the moon, necklace of cowries, hide armor, armlets, bracelets, leather gloves, anklets, leather shoes, and so forth were put on. Going around the mighty bow, he took it, bent it on his folded legs, and twanged the string gently, making the wild animals flee in terror at the thunderous sound. Thinnan then shone like the blue lily. At this stage, the ancient inspired dame came to him with sacrificial offerings, put the grains of the sacred rice on his forehead, and explained that the glory that awaited him was beyond description and far above the achievements of all his forebearers. After paying her due honors, Thinnan sent out for the hunt like a dark water-laden cloud. His many followers sped behind him with bows, swords, and shields. The hounds with lolling tongues ran in different directions, symbolizing the coming in of the goddess of victory. The huntsmen then set up snares to catch the wild animals in front of the hero that was out to cut asunder all the snares of this worldly life. The hero's eyes looked afar. Was not he to glimpse the Lord with just one eye ere long? Ay, the Lord, with the matted tresses, with the conroy blossom, where abide the crescent moon and the holy Ganga, and whom the Vedas ever search in vain to discover. Long horns, short flute-like instruments, and drums now set up a great din. The claps of hands too spread out into the jungle. The serried ranks of the dark-skinned hunters on the march looked like the turbulent waters of the Yamuna River rushing to merge itself in the wild sea along with the Ganga. The hunters pursued the fleeing animals, herds of deer, hogs, and so forth, through the thick forest by the tracks left by them as espied by scouts. After all preparations were made and encircling snares set up, Thinnan went forward towards the slope of the hill with his bow and arrows, leaving the hounds to chase in the 8 cardinal points. The fierce arrows blazed a trail in the jungle, and beats of drum and the like aroused the wild animals, boars, stags, deer, buffaloes, tuskers, tigers, bears, etc. The arrows shot in succession wrought great havoc among the beasts. Legs, loins, hands, and intestines were severed. Tigers rose up and fell. Some tigers wrathfully hit at the fatal shafts. As Thinnan's arrows flew and wrought destruction among the dark tuskers and fierce lions, it looked as though night and day were in close embrace. Black deer, bears, and buffaloes fell like dark clouds pouring rain into the sea. As the wild animals caught in snares tried to break out through them, the fierce hounds obstructed them like the 5 senses overpowering the mind set on the right path in order to escape from the twin snares of good and evil actions. The hunters, despite their cruel nature, chased not the young animals, the pregnant beasts, and those about to mate. Suddenly, a fierce boar with fiery eyes and thunderous roar broke through the snares and came charging like a dark cloud. The hunters at once set to attack it from different directions. Cardan and his comrade Nanan now managed to stick together without getting parted from Thinnan too. The boar fled far and stood at bay at the base of the hill. The hunter chief now plunged a dagger into its belly, spilling the intestines, to the dismay of Nanan, who along with Kadan had hoped to make the kill. These two now proposed to Thinnan that they might appease their growing hunger by roasting the flesh of the boar and eating it and having a good drink of water. When inquired about it, Nanan intimated that there was a cool stream, Pomohali, beyond the jungle flowing near the hill. Bidding the companions to bear the slain boar, Thinnan now set out towards the hill where abode the Lord who rode the red-eyed bull for his mount. Walking 5 miles, they reached the hill. When Thinnan proposed that they might ascend it, Nanan, agreeing, said that they would have the beauteous vision of the golden Lord of Kalahasti, Konamil, Kudimi Tevar, and adore him. Thinnan now felt that he was about to cast off a burden from him, and his heart was filled with a great longing and inquired, "Where abides my Lord?" Then they all reached the bank of the river Muhali. Leaving Kadan on the bank of the river, Thinnan went with Nanan, waded across the limpid waters and reached the base of the Kalahasti Mount. His mind then became clearer and a great joy welled up in his heart. At noon, there was heard a great din above the mount. Nanan thought that it should be the humming of swarms of bees drinking the honey from the blossoms on high. Now the great austerities done by Tinnan in previous births began to fructify. His heart sought eternal bliss. Higher and higher rose his zeal and longing for the Lord. His bones melted as it were with the surging love. Nanan led the way up. Tinnan's love too went ahead of him. He ascended the progressive steps of the tattvas to embrace the Shiva Shakti. As he neared the top of the mountain, the Lord's compassionate glance fell upon his devotee. Even without his cognition, straightway the load of age-long karmas vanished, and in the shade of the eternal flame, Tinnan became devotion personified. He then saw the tender sprout atop the sky-kissing mount. The Supreme Lord, his feet hurried with overpowering love in a daze. He clasped the Lord. He smelt the crown of the Lord. He stood entranced. Over all his limbs the hairs stood on end. His eyes streamed tears. Ah, him whom I had been seeking for ages has been caught here. Like the hardy men of all tribe, my Lord has been left alone without a friend to brave the peril of the forest. Woe is me that I have not cognized this earlier. The mighty bow slipped from his hand unaware. Then he noticed that leaves and flowers were strewn over the Lord. The linga and water too had been poured. He thought that it was a slight offered to the Lord, and inquired of Nanan about its perpetrator. Nanan replied that during former hunts he had seen a Brahmin doing such rites, muttering chants, and that he should have done so even that day. The passionate Tinnan thought, "Is this then a ministration pleasing to the Lord? I shall do likewise. But then how can I go out leaving my Lord alone to fetch meat for his food and water to bathe him in? He would take one step downward and then come back and repeat this oft." He was like a cow about to leave her beloved calf. At last he made up his mind to go down, invoking blessings on the Lord for his safety. All his other attachments were cut asunder, his love hurrying him fast towards the river, his companion being left far behind. Kadan then met him and blamed him for having delayed so long while the cooking boar meat was ready to be eaten. Nanan replied, "This man has caught the Lord of the mountain and would not let go his hold on him. Like an Udumba gripping the hole in a tree, he had now come only to take this meat to his Lord. He is lost to us hereafter." Hearing Nanan's words about Tinnan, Kadan exclaimed, "What is it that you have done, O Tinna, that delusion has come over you? Aren't you our great chieftain?" But Tinnan did not care even to look at the face of the speaker. He busied himself with roasting the boar flesh in the fire and putting in the tender pieces, after tasting them in his mouth, into a leaf receptacle. The bystanders then thought, "Surely he is greatly deluded. He spits out the juicy flesh from his mouth. He does not eat it. Though he is greatly hungry, he does not give a bite even to us. He throws on the ground the meat he does not want. We will go and inform his father of his sad state, so that with the help of the inspired dame, the spell may be cast off." So Tinnan's companions left him together with the other forest men. Then Tinnan hurried fast towards his Lord with the flesh in the leaf receptacle, the water for bathing kept in his mouth, and the freshly gathered flowers bound over his dresses. My dear Lord will be very hungry and tired. When he neared the rising sprout at the top of the mountain, the source of all, the Supreme Lord, he removed the flower wreath on the top with his shining curved leather sandal and poured out the water brought in his mouth over the immaculate Lord. He was then pouring out only by surging love. Then he took off the wreath from his dresses and put it on the crown of the Lord of the Mount. Next he offered the flesh food to the Lord with his crimson palm, saying, "This flesh has been roasted properly. It is a taste. I have myself tasted with my experienced palate. It is very nice indeed. Pray be pleased to relish it. He thought that the Lord would require much more food of this kind. The sun now set as if adoring the loving devotee with its myriad rays. Seeing the coming on of night, Thinnan thought, "My Lord cannot be left alone in the darkness. When fierce wild beasts will roam." So with unmixed love, he kept vigil the livelong night, holding the bow in his hand, a veritable dark mount himself. The blessed Thinnan beheld the Lord face to face, loving, waiting for the long night to pass away. Ah, his blessing is denied to the great sages of fierce austerities and celestials. In the darkness, the bamboo pearls shed a gentle glow, while the gems shed by serpents sent forth a flaming lustre. Where the moon and the sun adoring the Lord together as of a new moon day, the brilliance of rubies, emeralds, and sapphires sent the darkness into cover. In truth, there was no darkness in the precincts of the Lord's mount. Amidst the sheen of glowing trees, the lustre of serpent gems, and the divine halo of the sages who had controlled their senses and put down the six foes of greed, anger, and so forth. To be continued.